Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mama, You Are Enough, How to Create Calm, Joy, and Confidence Within the Chaos of Motherhood, by Claire Nicogossian, narrated by Coleen Marlo. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to tables, diagrams, and charts present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. I love my children, but I hate being around them. I can't wait for them to be in school all day. I wanted nothing more than to be a mom, but the thing is, I never expected it to be like this. I've lost myself, and I don't even know who I am anymore. I yell at my children all the time, and I feel so guilty for losing control. These are some of the countless statements I've heard in the therapy room from overwhelmed and stressed mothers. Becoming a mother is a life-changing event, and as a licensed clinical psychologist with more than 2 decades of clinical experience supporting mothers, I've seen that on the journey of mothering, many women are neither prepared for nor expect the stress and strain that come with raising a child. Years ago, I noticed a trend in the therapy hour: mothers needing support, compassion, and skills to cope with the stress of motherhood. They were experiencing many challenging emotions, but were apprehensive to share these feelings with friends or family for fear of judgment. It was in response to these hundreds of women in different stages of mothering that I wrote this book. The goal of this book is to help mothers identify, label, and manage the challenging emotions of motherhood, which I call shadow emotions. Feelings ranging from sadness and tearfulness to guilt, anxiety, loneliness, burnout, frustration, resentment, disgust, and shame. The reason I call them shadow emotions is because when we label emotions or even experiences, interactions, or people as good or bad, positive or negative, right or wrong, we create very rigid and distinct ways of thinking. Labeling this way creates judgment, and when we judge something or someone, we break the connection between ourselves and that emotion or person and create a decision, a fixed belief. By letting go of the common good versus bad labels and instead viewing our challenging emotions as more neutral shadows, we create an opportunity to be curious, to look beyond surface details, to be open-hearted, and to connect on a deeper level with ourselves, our emotions, our experiences, and other people. In my private practice, mothers who were stressed, depressed, or anxious would sit on the couch and share with me the shadow emotions they were experiencing. In the confines of a safe, non-judgmental space, they felt enormous relief hearing that it's normal to experience shadow emotions in mothering. It's okay to feel shadow emotions in motherhood for several reasons. One, feeling shadow emotions doesn't mean you have to act on the emotion. Two, feeling shadow emotions doesn't mean that you don't love your children enough. And three, feeling shadow emotions in motherhood does not equate to being a bad mother. Without this assurance, though, many mothers continue to leave their shadow emotions unmanaged. They put a lot of effort into protecting and shielding these feelings, lest they ever be revealed. As mothers, we've crafted a narrative at home, at work, and within our children's schools and neighborhoods. Everything is fine. Everything is perfect. We're happy, satisfied, and loving every minute of every day of mothering. But there is a hidden cost to not being honest. Mothers are often left feeling isolated, judged, worried, and concerned that they are failing at parenting. Almost 2 decades ago, when I became a mother to twin girls, I experienced firsthand what I had been hearing from clients for years in the therapy room. Parenting is a never-ending giving of oneself. Today, I am a mother to 4 children, and I too have experienced many of the shadow emotions described in this book. Inspired by mothers in the therapy room, in addition to what I was hearing from friends and moms in my community and often experiencing myself, I began to explore the trends I observed. I found research supporting what I was seeing and experiencing. In today's fast-paced world, mothers are overwhelmed and stressed juggling the demands of work, home, relationships, and family. In moments of stress, moms experience a range of shadow emotions, but seldom talk about their feelings. And when they do talk about the hard stuff in mothering, they almost always preface their confession of the shadow emotions by trying to reassure and persuade their listener that they really do love and care for their children. Part of this disclaimer comes from fear of judgment and wondering what others may think when they share something like, "I love my children more than anything, but some days I wonder how I can keep on giving myself. I'm losing myself, and I hate how I feel being around my kids. I just need a break." These are what I call the shadow moments of motherhood, moments that cast a shadow on experiencing happiness, as well as connecting and nurturing our child, ourselves, and other significant relationships. The truth is that shadow moments are part of motherhood. When we normalize these feelings by talking openly and honestly, without judging what mothers are feeling, we accomplish multiple things. We create a response of compassion without judgment. We help moms move from a place of being ashamed for what they feel to accepting their feelings. And we help moms open up to finding solutions and skills to manage shadow emotions, which I believe is the path to thriving in motherhood. I like to use impressionist art as a metaphor for motherhood. Using small dabs of bold paint in ways that can often appear to be messy layers, the artist creates a visual effect of light and form, depicting a subject from their personal point of view, or their impression. Standing in front of an impressionist painting, if you were to focus on one area of the painting close up, all you'd be able to see is dabs of color, messy and layered. To fully appreciate what the painting is about, you have to step back and get some perspective. It's the same in motherhood. Experiences and moments are the paint, and motherhood is the canvas. Shadow moments are dabs of darker colors, messy and chaotic at times. Focusing too closely on the shadow moments, we can get lost in them, believing that we're not good enough or that we're failing, when in fact, we're having a shadow moment, a dab of messy paint, all of which contributes to your canvas in motherhood. You don't have to know what the canvas is going to look like. These shadow moments are not all of you, they are part of you. Variations of light and dark and bold, vibrant, illuminating patterns that together create a beautiful, unique work of art on your path and journey through motherhood. Throughout this book, we will explore the authentic, vulnerable, and very real shadow sides of motherhood, embracing them and learning from them, which creates a mosaic of healing as we move beyond them. Introduction. Every hour of the light and dark is a miracle. Walt Whitman. On a fall morning many years ago, I set out to plant tulip bulbs with my 2.5-year-old daughter, Anna. Her older twin sisters were at school, and her 5-month-old baby sister, Lauren, was taking a nap. Relishing an opportunity for sacred one-on-one time with just a single child, I gathered all of the supplies needed for Anna and me to spend some time planting on this particular October morning. Bulbs, hand shovels, and gardening gloves, a set for each of us. If you've raised a child through ages 2 and 3, you know all too well the challenges that come with this developmental age. Wild mood swings, a quest for independence and autonomy, blossoming personality interests and will, and the all-too-familiar response to many requests, no. Anna must not have gotten the memo that we were supposed to have a pleasant morning of bonding, because she had one epic meltdown. At first, all seemed to go well as we kneeled on our gardening mats, digging holes and placing bulbs into the moist soil. About 5 minutes into gardening, as she was digging into the soil, Anna spotted a squirming worm. The worm startled her and sent her running to the driveway. No coaxing or reasoning could get her back to my side. I asked Anna to sit on the steps close to me while I finished planting the row of bulbs. She refused. Instead, Anna ran across the street to see a neighbor's cat, leaving my spot. I ran to get Anna and brought her back across the street, telling her about safety and not crossing the street without an adult. And here is where the power struggle began. A power struggle that waged pretty consistently over the next 6 months. Bringing her back to our house and asking her to sit on the steps while I finished planting was a futile request. Anna started making demands to visit the neighbor's cat, eat apples, change her clothes, go inside, you name it. She wanted nothing to do with our morning of gardening. I ignored her, trying to go about my planting, hoping she'd burn off some energy and come around. No such luck. It was as if on that day a switch was flipped, and Anna decided that for the next 6 months, everything I suggested she'd reject, challenge, or argue about. It was an exhausting time for both of us. As a mother of four daughters, I count myself fortunate that this was the first time I had experienced such an intense, scary shadow moment of not wanting to be around my child. Of course, I loved her and treated Anna with kindness and nurturance, but I dreaded mothering her because I felt so ineffective. The parenting skills that I used with my twins and that had worked for 9 years at this point, quite well, I might add, did not work with Anna. When the same parenting skills didn't work with Anna, I felt exhausted, overwhelmed, and inept at caring for her. And these feelings lasted on and off for 6 months. Call it the terrible twos or threes, whatever it was, this was a difficult time in mothering. Then one morning in April, as Anna and I returned home after walking the twins to the bus, Anna approached our walkway and squealed with delight as the tulips we planted 6 months before were blooming. Excited, she said, "Mommy, those flowers we planted last Halloween, they came up." "Yes, Anna, they did. Those bulbs we planted are becoming beautiful flowers," I said. "That was a fun day, Mommy. We should plant more flowers." And off she went running in the yard. I stood there staring at the red teacup-shaped tulips, tears welling in my eyes, and thought, she thought it was a fun day, while I thought it was the beginning of a super challenging time with so many shadow moments mothering her. What a different place we are in compared to last fall. Around this time, it was as if the switch that had turned on and started the difficulty between us turned off just as quickly. The irrationality, tantrums, and meltdowns subsided. I had my sweet, loving, agreeable, and full of wonder Anna back. I shared this story with you because it was a powerful time in mothering when I felt so many intense shadow emotions. Of course, I had many shadow moments before this period, but those 6 months with Anna, as I cared for four children under the age of 9, one of whom was a very strong-willed 2-year-old, were some of the most challenging experiences of motherhood I had experienced up to that point. As a person who sees the world through metaphors, I can't help but see the comparisons and similarities between planting and motherhood. As a mama for almost 2 decades, I've come to see motherhood as a cycle of growth, much like a tulip's. Darkness, anticipation, uncertainty, change, joy, celebration, and reward. As different as our mothering journeys may be, we all share the similarity of growing through uncertainty and the unknown, learning about ourselves and our children along the way as we nurture and care for tiny humans. Think back to when you first knew you were going to be a mother. Whether your child grew in your body or your heart, if you're a mama who has fostered, adopted, or surrogated, the beginning of motherhood is filled with many unknowns. We begin motherhood in the dark, unaware of the range of emotions we're going to experience: anticipation, shock, surprise, fear, worry, joy, and many more. So much of our emotional experience in motherhood starts in the dark and the unknown. My journey as a mother to my twins began with many shadow emotions, along with major physical challenges from complications in my pregnancy and their birth. The first year of motherhood was incredible. I was overwhelmed with love, joy, and gratitude, as well as stress, exhaustion, frustration, sadness, fear, and worry. Despite my 2 advanced degrees, I felt emotions that no one had ever warned me about, nor had I heard such feelings being talked about. When I began to experience stressful and confusing emotions, such as overwhelm, irritability, exhaustion, and boredom, I felt ashamed to have such feelings in the midst of my gratitude for being a mother. How could I feel shadow emotions when I had 2 healthy, thriving babies? I was conflicted, feeling intense emotions along with profound gratitude and love. I remember feeling myself go through the motions of caring for my babies, bored, lonely, and unfulfilled. I wondered if other new moms felt this way, juxtaposed between gratitude and exhaustion, love and overwhelm. I was apprehensive about voicing my feelings. I had tested the water by bringing up my feelings to other mom friends and family members to see if honestly sharing my emotions about motherhood was acceptable. For example, when someone would ask how things were going with the twins, I would say, "Well, they're sleeping through the night and doing great, but I'm so tired. I'd love some time to myself." In response, I would hear phrases like, "Oh, all moms feel that way, but enjoy these moments. They grow up so fast." Or, "They're such a blessing. You're so fortunate." Or, "I didn't feel that way. I loved every minute with my children." Well-intentioned friends, family, or other moms would reassure me, dismiss my feelings, or give me an ominous warning about my children being babies for a short time. I quickly learned it was socially unacceptable to talk about the truth of shadow emotions in motherhood. Toni Morrison, the American author and editor who won a Nobel Prize in Literature in 1993, once said, "If there's a book that you want to read but hasn't been written yet, then you must write it." This is one of my core motivations to write the book you are now listening to. This is the book I wanted to read when I first became a mother, a book to help me understand the shadow emotions I was experiencing in motherhood that I knew other moms must be experiencing, but were apprehensive to voice at playdates, school drop-offs, and social gatherings. I wanted a realistic portrayal of the range of feelings, from positive to negative and everything in between, to be brought out of the shadows and into the light. As a psychologist, I was hearing some of the same feelings I experienced expressed in the therapy hour, and I found myself repeating, not only to myself, but to moms, "Just because you experience certain feelings doesn't mean you have to be defined by these feelings, nor do you have to act on your feelings. You can have shadow emotions and continue to be a competent, loving, grateful mother." As a mother who is in the midst of raising a family and as a clinical psychologist supporting mamas, I want you to know this. It's okay to feel irritable, depleted, and lonely in motherhood. It's okay to feel sad, frustrated, and bored. It's okay to feel so overwhelmed or angry that you don't know how you'll find the energy to get up and do this all over again tomorrow. You can experience these shadow emotions and love and adore your children with every cell and breath in your body. You are not alone, and this book is going to help you learn to manage your shadow emotions and thrive in motherhood. I'm so glad you found this book, because here you will learn about yourself and your emotions, the awesome ones we all imagine when we become mothers: joy, gratitude, love, adoration, contentment, appreciation, and the shadow emotions that catch us off guard, such as anger, sadness, fear, disgust, and embarrassment. In these pages, you're going to find the whole experience of motherhood, not just the moments we anticipate and look forward to, intentionally portray when we leave the house, or carefully curate on social media. The journey of motherhood is a great unknown, unfamiliar at times. We don't always know what to do with, how to react to, or how to manage the emotions we experience. But over time, if we stay committed to caring for ourselves, nurturing our relationships, and managing our feelings, thoughts, and behaviors, we can get through the challenging times in motherhood. We can start to feel more brightness, happiness, gratitude, and well-being. This book is going to inspire you to appreciate yourself and embrace the whole experience of motherhood without judging yourself, which in turn will bring more compassion and understanding into your life so you can thrive in motherhood. This book is divided into 5 main shadow emotions: sadness, fear and anxiety, anger, embarrassment, and disgust. With each section, there is a general description of the shadow emotion in motherhood, and chapters that explore the variations of these shadow emotions, and how these feelings can present in motherhood. Each chapter is structured with helpful information, including how to reframe negative self-talk, termed as shadow mantras, to positive and compassionate self-talk, called thriving mantras. There are also specific skills and strategies for each shadow feeling called moving beyond the shadows, which will help you manage and move past the shadow emotion you're experiencing. At the end of each chapter is an inspiring, thriving mama reflection to help you feel inspired to bring self-compassion for yourself into motherhood. The cornerstone of therapy is trust, connection, and confidentiality. In this book, there are some examples in motherhood of moms experiencing shadow emotions. None of the descriptions identify any specific individuals. To illustrate examples in motherhood, all names are fictitious, and clinical issues and presentations have been combined to create an illustration for the emotion or struggle highlighted. Any recognizable details have been altered. Therefore, any resemblance of an individual for a case example to any actual person is entirely coincidental. Part 1. Learning to Thrive in Modern Motherhood. Chapter 1. The Key to Thriving in Motherhood: Understanding and Managing Your Emotions and Feelings. Every emotion has a source and a key that opens it. Rumi. I can think of no role in life that compares to the emotional experience of motherhood. Before becoming a mother, with 2 advanced degrees in mental health and psychological functioning, I thought I knew a lot about emotional states impacting thoughts, behaviors, and experiences in a person's life. Then I became a mother, and all that prior experience and education no longer applied. Becoming a mother creates a heightened awareness of the intensity of human emotions. Think back to the time before you were a mom. Think about the feelings or thoughts you had. Now think about becoming a mother. Wouldn't you agree that you felt more emotions and have had more thoughts and experiences that intensified what it means to be a human in the role as a mother? Motherhood is an ever-evolving journey, one in which we learn about ourselves via nurturing and caring for our children. Motherhood is not an isolated experience built on one moment or event. It's a process of self-discovery and understanding that provides an opportunity to experience astounding love, compassion, and understanding for ourselves, our child, and our partner. Motherhood is sacred, but it's not immune to the ups and downs of life or to one's emotions. Happiness and anger and every emotion in between. Motherhood isn't one experience. It's all of these things. And like anything complete, there will be moments, often many moments, that force us to stop, pay attention, and refocus. Being a mother involves being a caregiver, protector, nurturer, teacher, nurse, counselor, chef, chauffeur, and advocate. With so many roles, motherhood can feel tiring, demanding, and overwhelming. Of course, motherhood is a lovely, inspiring, and divine gift. Motherhood can be and is not limited to being divine and superficial, a blessing and a strain, joyful and enraging, peaceful and chaotic, happy and depressing, connected and lonely, confident and uncertain, a source of love and disdain. And in these extremes, there is a range from mild to severe emotions that make up a continuum of emotional experiences in motherhood. But all of these contrasts make up the whole of motherhood, just like a beautiful impressionist painting. Motherhood is a series of shadow moments and lovely moments, dabs of paint both light and dark. Focusing on only one part of motherhood, for example, the shadow moments with your child, takes away the perspective of viewing motherhood as a whole, which is beautiful and unique. To be a mother is a sacred calling, not given to everyone. And the surprising thing about motherhood is we can never truly anticipate the role of a lifetime until we are in the position of nurturing a beautiful soul. And that's why it's critical to understand the shadow side of mothering. Because when we learn of a baby or child coming into our lives, whether we planned and worked for our child or they came as a surprise, we are forever changed. When I was pregnant with my babies, I'd have thoughts and dreams of what they would look like and who they'd become. I'd imagine what it would be like to feel their hands hold mine or their arms hug me. I didn't think about how they wouldn't sleep for days, refuse to eat, or be difficult to soothe. I didn't anticipate the fear and helplessness I'd feel when they were sick and I couldn't do anything to make them feel better as they cried in pain. I didn't imagine how tough it could be to find time to shower, eat a meal, or spend time with my husband and friends. And when I was pregnant, I could hardly imagine a day when my child would be disrespectful or lie, much less hurt a peer, a sibling, or me with an unkind word. I also never dreamed about the time my teenagers would roll their eyes at me, talk back, and blatantly ignore a request made of them. One of the most surprising things about motherhood is you can never fully know what to expect or how to manage the role until you're experiencing it. Which is why I believe mamas need support and guidance to understand the range of emotions experienced in motherhood. From the positive ones we expect, like love, joy, gratitude, awe, and contentment, to the shadow emotions that catch us off guard, like sadness, fear, disgust, anger, and embarrassment, which I call shadow emotions. Understanding shadow emotions in motherhood. We live in a world where it's natural to put things in categories, good or bad, healthy or unhealthy, strong or weak, happy or sad, positive and negative. Placing things in categories can be helpful at times, but often, doing so is a rigid and inflexible way of looking at things. Describing situations or experiences in such extremes is quick and streamlined, but a tad judgmental, decreasing an opportunity to understand something and yourself in more depth and with curiosity. I prefer to see things on a continuum, in a range of variations, and emotions are a perfect example. Emotions are often labeled as positive or negative. The positive ones bring us joy, happiness, and contentment, and they're the ones we strive to feel. On the other hand, the negative emotions are the ones we want to avoid, push away, ignore, diminish, and remove from our experiences. But I see avoiding or suppressing our emotions as problematic. Our desire not to experience the negative emotions prevents us from understanding ourselves on a deeper level. Here is what I know from 2 decades of being a therapist. No feeling or emotion is negative or bad. All emotions and feelings, even shadow emotions, are simply pieces of information about what we are experiencing or responding to in any given moment. Just like actual shadows created by clouds on a sunny day, emotions are neither good nor bad. They are simply part of life. Shadow emotions are the challenging emotions and feelings we experience, the ones that push us outside of our comfort zone or feel unpleasant. Experiencing a shadow emotion creates an opportunity to pause and check in with ourselves as to what we are experiencing. Instead of reacting without intention or awareness, when we experience a shadow emotion, we can pause. Take a compassionate and curious approach to understand what we are feeling and use skills and strategies as outlined in this book, deciding on how we'd like to respond. Managing shadow emotions is an act of self-care. Putting this in greater context, if you are a mother of an older child, I'm sure you have heard them say, "I'm afraid of the dark." And what do we usually say to this child? "There is nothing to be scared of. You are safe, and I'm right here." If the child persists, perhaps you offer a nightlight or rub their back and stroke their head and hair. Maybe you sing a lullaby or give a hug and kiss for reassurance. Perhaps, if the child continues to need more because of their fear, you listen to them and ask what you can do to help. Maybe they'll request that you check under the bed, close the closet door, or give them a cherished stuffed animal, all gestures that bring comfort to them. Now think for a moment about when you were scared of the dark. But this time, the darkness is not at night. I know plenty of moms who relish the hours in the evening when children are asleep, the house is quiet, and they finally have a moment to themselves. I'm talking about the darkness of having felt afraid or judged when you experienced a shadow emotion. Perhaps it was a time when you felt overwhelmed, exhausted, or stressed, and you could barely handle all of the responsibilities of your life. Or maybe it was a moment of loving your child so much, but feeling so unfulfilled as a person. Or those moments in motherhood when you lose your temper with your child and say hurtful things out of frustration. And while your child accepts your apology, you lament in the guilt for having lost your temper and the fear you have permanently damaged your child with your rage. As a mother and a psychologist, I can say this. You can experience dark moments and shadow emotions in motherhood and still be grateful for your child, adore being a mother, and continue to be a good mother. Motherhood is seldom defined in one moment. It is a series of events and years of nurturing, protecting, teaching, and guiding your child through development and life. By bringing light and awareness to the shadow emotions in motherhood, we can make changes and improve not only our children's lives, but also our own lives. So while you may feel an emotion, it doesn't mean you have to dwell on that emotion. It doesn't mean you're defined by the emotions you feel, or that you have to act on the emotion. Instead, you can be informed and pause for a moment, reflect, and choose how to respond. This is the core component of managing emotions, choosing a healthy way to respond instead of an unhealthy way of reacting. In this book, five categories of shadow emotions are explored. 1. Sadness. 2. Fear. 3. Anger. 4. Embarrassment. And 5. Disgust. Because emotions exist on a continuum, within each broad shadow emotion, you will hear about a range of specific feelings in varying intensities, from mild and moderate feelings to more intense and severe emotional reactions. Refer to the Mother Mood Wheel of Emotions to see how I approach our main emotions, including both the shadow emotions and joy, broken down into their more specific and intense feelings. You can also download it on momswellbeing.com. Some of the feelings will be familiar to you, and others you may seldom experience, if you experience them at all. And that is okay. Remember, there is no judgment. Rather, you must simply open up to awareness and understanding about what you experience. Over my years of clinical experience, I have developed the following 10 truths that, when deeply understood, can lead to powerful transformation in your journey through the emotions of motherhood. 10 truths about emotions and feelings in motherhood. 1. Emotions and feelings are neither good nor bad. 2. An emotion or feeling does not define you or your abilities as a mother. 3. Experiencing an emotion or feeling doesn't mean you have to act on it. 4. Feelings and emotions provide opportunities for awareness and reflection, which leads to self-growth. 5. Emotions and feelings can be experienced along a continuum from mild to moderate to intense to severe. 6. Emotional states can be temporary, linger for short amounts of time, as well as be more lasting and pervasive states of being. 7. Judging an emotional state with phrases like, I shouldn't feel this, or I wish I didn't feel this, blocks self-compassion and understanding and delays an opportunity for personal growth. 8. Emotions and feelings are wise parts of ourselves. When we do not acknowledge or pay attention to them, they will find a way to be seen, whether we want them to or not. 9. Even when it's challenging, showing compassion for our emotions and feelings creates opportunities for growth and healing. 10. Taking care of your emotional state is a crucial component of thriving in motherhood. Motherhood Wheel of Emotions. Anger. Annoyed. Irritable. Frustrated. Upset. Mad. Hurt. Judgmental. Furious, enraged, bitter, resentful, jealous, envious. Disgust, avoidance, disapproval, gross, repulsed, hatred, revolted, nauseated, self-loathing, self-hatred, embarrassment and surprise, awkward, shy, startled, confused, humiliated, ashamed, shocked, perplexed, thrilled, joy, confident, accepted, calm, creative, playful, appreciative, loving, trusting, optimistic, proud, hopeful, peaceful, curious, inspired, fulfilled, grateful, compassionate. Fear and anxiety, inadequate, worried, nervous, afraid, insecure, frantic, panicked, anxious, scared, terrified. Sadness, tearful, ineffective, awful, empty, depleted, disappointed, regretful, guilty, alone, lonely, burned out, defeated, helpless, depressed, hopeless, grief, overwhelmed. Breaking down emotions and feelings. In my work and through my experience as a mother, I have come to believe one of the most essential skills needed to thrive in motherhood is emotional self-care, which is being able to identify, understand, label, and manage your emotions and feelings. And while emotions and feelings sound like similar things, there are significant, albeit subtle, differences. Knowing these differences will help you be more aware and compassionate with yourself and what you're feeling and experiencing. Let's start with the basics. An emotion is something our human brains are hardwired from birth to experience. No one teaches us how to experience emotions. We're born with the capacity to experience them. Emotions are powerful responses to how we interpret, respond, and act in life. And while there is a lot of debate about how many emotions are hardwired to experience, I embrace the model of 8 primary emotions: sadness, anger, fear, disgust, joy, surprise, interest, and embarrassment, shame. Emotions contain 3 components. 1, a physical component. 2, a cognitive component. And 3, a neurological component. The physical component of experiencing an emotion happens when we have a physical reaction to a situation and begin to feel changes in our body. We may experience a racing heart, tense muscles, sweating, tearfulness, and so on. The physical reaction alone doesn't identify the emotion. For example, think about tears, which you might cry for many reasons, such as sadness, exhaustion, fear, relief, or joy. The physical component of an emotion or feeling is scanning what you are experiencing in your body. The physical sensations cue us into what we may be experiencing. For example, emotional responses often create some combination of the following physical symptoms: stomach distress, a rush of energy, muscle tension, sweating, tiredness or fatigue, racing heart or palpitations, tearfulness or crying, shortness of breath, racing thoughts, jitteriness or restlessness. Think about a racing heart and changes in breathing. Many things can create a racing heart and change your breathing. Exercising or carrying your child, exertion. Seeing your child walk, excitement. Hearing a loud thud, fear. Or catching your child climbing out of the crib for the first time, surprise. A racing heart and changes in your breathing are emotional responses to something. But what emotion do they indicate? The answer is that we could be experiencing many emotions. This truth is why we also need to understand the cognitive component of emotional responses, which is understanding how our thoughts and appraisal of the situation can decrease or increase our emotional response. Our thoughts help us understand what we are experiencing. What we think about, perceive, and experience influences the kind of thoughts we all have, which in turn contributes to our emotional health. Thoughts also influence how we respond to situations and the environment. For example, your elevated heart rate and breathing make sense when you're going for a brisk walk while pushing your child in a stroller. But if your heart races in the middle of the night and wakes you out of a deep sleep, it may take you a minute to figure out why you're having this physical experience. Was it because you heard a noise? Did you have a bad dream? Or are you having panic episodes? A physical response requires a mental or cognitive component to label, decode, and decipher in order to understand what is happening. Third, emotions have a neurological or brain chemistry component. Our bodies produce hundreds of chemicals in the brain called neurochemicals, which influence feelings, thoughts, and behaviors. For example, dopamine, serotonin, and oxytocin have been called the happy hormones. Oxytocin, for instance, is referred to as the bonding hormone, responsible for empathy, intimacy, and trust. This chemical is released in the brain during physical contact and intimacy. For example, hugging, cuddling, sexual activity, or nursing a baby. Disruption in the levels of these neurochemicals, such as dopamine and serotonin, can impact everything from sleep to appetite and mood to energy levels and the kind of thoughts we have. All three of these components work together to create the emotions and feelings we experience. Emotional responses. Why feelings matter. Generally speaking, an emotion is an automatic response to something we experience. This means you don't have to do anything. The emotion happens in response to an internal or external situation. In session, I often use this example to describe an emotion. Let's imagine you're driving home from an evening outing. All of a sudden, a deer jumps into the road from the ditch, crossing your path close to your car. In response, you automatically slam the brakes to miss hitting the deer. As you do, everything in the front seat, your purse, a few groceries, falls to the floor from the passenger seat. In a matter of seconds, your heart is racing, your stomach drops, your arms and shoulders are tense, and your knees are shaking as the deer darts off into the darkness and you resume driving home. The emotion you're feeling is a combination of surprise, initiated by how fast the deer ran into the road, and fear, initiated by a threat of danger. This example illustrates the automatic response of an emotion. A feeling is an emotional response to an internal or external situation or event that is influenced by our thoughts, experiences, culture, and personal history. Feelings are emotional responses personal to us, based on our individual differences and experiences. To illustrate, let's think about the example of the deer darting in front of your car. You made it home safe after the stressful drive and go right into the evening routine with your family, making dinner, getting ready for the next day, bathing your child, reading them a bedtime story, and putting them to bed. As you lay down to sleep, your head hits the pillow, and although you're tired, you can't drift off because all you can think about is the what-ifs that could have happened with the deer. What if your children had been in the car? What if you had been on the phone? What if your little ones had been asking you to play music and you didn't see the deer? What if you had hit the deer? What if you had been injured? What if your child had been hurt, or worse? All of these thoughts create so much distress that you can't sleep. This is an example of a feeling of worry and panic fueled by your thoughts of how potentially dangerous the situation could have been. In contrast, let's say for the past few months you've been working hard to reduce your distracted driving. Instead of talking on the phone in the car or checking your texts at stoplights, you've made an effort not to touch your phone when driving. After the deer darted in front of your vehicle and you stopped in time, you head home and go into the evening routine. As your head hits the pillow, you have a profound sense of gratitude and appreciation for your new practice of not driving distractedly, and go to bed with a sense of peace and relief for changing on one's problematic behavior. Same situation, two different feelings, based on an individual's thoughts, experiences, and personal history. In summary, an emotion is an automatic response that we don't control. A feeling is an emotional response influenced by our thoughts, which we can control, our experiences, and our personal history. Let's dive deeper into how thoughts influence our feelings. How negative and self-critical thinking increases shadow emotions and feelings. Our thoughts can be tricky. Thoughts are always with us. We can have them anytime and anywhere, and it's challenging to make them go away. If I tell you not to think of a pink elephant, I can almost guarantee you will immediately think of a pink elephant. And not only are thoughts hard to get rid of, but also on any given day, we have thousands of them. Some experts estimate we have between 60,000 to 80,000 thoughts a day. I think when you're a mom, the number is even higher, closer to 100,000. And I think the number of thoughts increases by several thousand with each additional child. So whatever your estimate, if you're a mom, you have a lot of thoughts every day. Moms think about what everyone needs, often multitasking and juggling so many things at once for their family, work, and responsibilities. When a mom is thinking about what her family needs all the time, she is bearing what is called the mental load. The mental load is composed of all the behind-the-scenes responsibilities, from scheduling and attending doctor's appointments, signing permission forms for field trips, and making it to social events to buying gifts for parties, organizing play dates, and balancing sports practices and activities. The mental load and the to-do list of what her family needs, it never stops. When a mom's mind is too full, continually thinking and doing for everyone, this can be a perfect breeding ground for stress. A mama's thoughts don't stop at what her family needs. Throughout the day, she has many thoughts that can be described in the following categories. Positive, moments of appreciation and gratitude, and caring thoughts towards herself, others, and the larger world. Neutral, neither positive nor negative thoughts, which include thinking about to-do lists, tasks that need to be accomplished, things to do or places to go, as well as any narration describing what she is doing, where she is going, or what she may need to do. Negative, critical judgments, statements, and observations about herself, others, or the larger world. When the majority of a mother's thoughts become negative, whether she thinks negative thoughts about others or whether she is self-critical and engages in negative self-talk, if she believes every thought is true and does not challenge the negative thinking and manage it, everyday life has the potential to become fraught with problems. Think back to the example of you're not being able to sleep because of all the what-ifs that could have happened had you hit the deer. Not challenging your thoughts created distress, and you weren't able to sleep because you were worrying about all the possible scenarios of danger. Negative self-talk, the negative statements, beliefs, or phrases we say to ourselves, has been shown to increase physical stress and arousal, creating challenging physical states and sensations, and fueling more negative thinking. As a psychologist, I spend a significant portion of my time educating and helping clients understand the power of thoughts. What we feel will influence the types of thoughts we have, the memories we recall, and the ways we choose to respond. And what we think about and focus on mentally will influence how we behave and what we can feel. Our thoughts influence our feelings, which in turn influence how we act and behave, which can create more emotional reactions, thoughts, and behaviors. Our thoughts, behaviors, feelings are interrelated and impact and influence one another. And it makes sense if you're feeling sad, chances are you have more sad thoughts, recall more sad events, and in response tend to react to others and your environment in sad behaviors, actions, which in essence then has the potential to create an increase in sad thoughts and more intense sad feelings and behaviors. Part of understanding our emotions and feelings is taking into account the thoughts we have associated with our feelings. And there's a good reason for this. Our thoughts can fuel and intensify our emotional reactions, or they can reduce a feeling. If the majority of our thoughts become negative and self-critical about ourselves or others, chances are those thoughts are going to increase feeling shadow emotions, as well as impact how we interact and function during our day. And this isn't just a matter of opinion. Here are some interesting findings from research on our thoughts. People who are depressed have more negative thoughts about themselves, other people, the world, and the future. A mood state, whether positive or negative, will impact the type of memories a person recalls. A person who is in a negative mood state will more readily recall negative memories, whereas an individual in a positive mood state will remember positive memories. People who are under pressure with many cognitive demands have increased thoughts of dying, one of the most reported unwanted thoughts. Listening to aggressive and violent songs can increase aggressive thoughts and feelings. For example, a research study of 500 college students showed that when the students spent time listening to violent musical lyrics, they had more violent and aggressive thoughts. Being engrossed in violent interactive video games is associated with increased aggression. Most people report intrusive and upsetting thoughts. Individuals with anxiety, OCD, obsessive-compulsive disorder, and worry believe the invasive thoughts as accurate and true, whereas those without anxiety, OCD, and worry can let the thought go. Being able to understand and identify the thoughts you have when you're experiencing an emotional reaction is an essential part of learning to thrive in motherhood. At this point, you may be thinking, "So I have negative thoughts a lot. Now what?" The good news is this. The first step in changing anything in your life is to be aware of and understand your thoughts. The next step is to challenge the thoughts using a skill called reframing. Reframing is a technique used to manage negative or inaccurate thoughts by considering a different point of view or an alternative perspective. One way to reframe is to ask yourself the following questions. Is this thought true? If so, where is the evidence for this? Is there another possible explanation for what may be happening in this situation? Am I taking this personally? If someone I cared for came to me with the same thought, how would I respond? Positive reframing is an important skill in thriving in motherhood because it takes away the judgment of yourself or another person, a situation or an event. Instead of categorizing someone or something as good or bad, reframing moves your thoughts into a broader understanding, seeking alternative explanations. Positive reframing is a skill that builds resiliency, helps manage stress, and allows you to move into a place of mental well-being. The chapters on the shadow emotions will help you learn the skill of reframing by sharing specific negative thoughts you may relate to and how they can be reframed to a positive perspective. These are called shadow mantras and thriving mantras. You'll hear more in the chapters that follow. Now that you have an overview of the shadow emotions and how thoughts impact feelings and behaviors, we will lay the foundation for moving into thriving mama mode through self-care. If your goal is to thrive in motherhood, then think of self-care as the steps that will get you there. Chapter 2, A Guide to Self-Care in Modern Motherhood. Thriving in motherhood is not about being perfect, never making a mistake, or having every moment of mothering go smoothly. Let's be real, motherhood is challenging, exhausting, and full of mistakes and conflict. At the same time, however, being a mother is amazing and rewarding. Being a mama in the modern world is a whole new way to parent. It requires navigating demands and pressures faced by no other generation in history. Compared to what our ancestors experienced, family life has changed dramatically. Almost half of American mothers are working full-time. It is less common for moms not to be in the workforce. Only a quarter of American families have one parent who does not work outside the home. And with these changes in family structure, modern family life means parents not only share the financial responsibility, but they're also sharing more of the household responsibilities. But things are slow to change, with mothers continuing to shoulder more of the day-to-day parenting responsibilities, household management, and the children's schedules, activities, academics, and medical needs.
including taking time off from work when a child is sick. Another stressor I've seen over the past 20 years of practice as a psychologist and as a mama raising children is the fact that more families are living farther away from their extended family, which means less support with raising children. And with both parents working, there is the added stress of daycare, after-school care, cleaning, cooking, and spending quality time together as a couple or a family. It's understandable why families take advantage of two-day delivery from Amazon, meal subscription services, grocery delivery, and restaurants. Families are maxed out and trying to streamline managing a household. By the time families come home after work, school, and activities, there is only a small window of time, often just a few hours, for dinner, homework, baths, and bedtime. Then families start all over the next day. Then there's the added layer of the modern world being connected 24/7 to news, information, and social media through smartphones and screens. We have created a culture focused on productivity with little downtime. Parenting through the digital era is complex. Parents are navigating screen time and social media and striving to keep childhood going as long as possible, while kids are getting phones and devices earlier and earlier. There is so much modern parents have to keep up with and be on top of in addition to the demands of working and raising a family. Some parts of parenting will never change, but modern parents have to juggle issues and concerns previous generations did not have to face. These are not better or worse from my perspective. It's a matter of complexity in modern parenting. Modern parents have the same number of hours in a day as parents of previous generations, but slowing down for family time, couple time, and self-care is more challenging than ever. I believe the two most valuable resources in parenting are time and energy. So many parents are exhausted, stressed, and overwhelmed, but they're not taking care of themselves. Many parents believe there's no time for self-care, do not understand the importance of self-care, or have difficulty transitioning out of production mode because there's a seemingly endless to-do list when raising a family. You may belong to the group of parents who wonder, is self-care really enough to fix the stress and overwhelm? Self-care won't lift all of life's burdens, but the intentional self-care that I'm sharing with you in this book is a great place to start. And you may point out another dilemma with self-care. How do parents fit in self-care with an already demanding and packed schedule? Believe me, I get it. As I raise my girls, finding the time and making self-care a priority can feel overwhelming. What I encourage clients and remind myself is that self-care is possible if you plan it and break it down into small steps you can take each day. Self-care doesn't have to be overwhelming and stressful or cost money. Self-care is a practice of knowing yourself and what you need to feel healthy and happy to thrive in motherhood. Self-care, at its simplest definition, is any activity or behavior that creates and maintains health and well-being. Self-care is made up of the intentions, actions, and behaviors you use to add joy and happiness to your life, as well as help you manage the stress of raising a family, the demands of work, and the responsibilities you're obligated to fulfill. I believe there are six primary dimensions of self-care in motherhood. 1. Physical. 2. Emotional. 3. Mental, cognitive. 4. Social. 5. Spiritual. And 6. Personal. Physical self-care. Physical self-care is any action or behavior focused on taking care of your body and physical health, including getting enough sleep, staying hydrated, eating healthy and nutritious food, being active, and exercising regularly. Physical self-care also includes routinely showering and grooming yourself, consuming caffeine and alcohol within healthy limits, going to medical appointments, and following recommended preventive care and interventions for your health-related issues and concerns. Physical self-care skills.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.